Your Excellencies, Member of European Parliament, Members of IFIMES Council, Members of IFIMES, Ladies and Gentlemen, dear friends. Allow me to welcome you in the name of the International Institute for Middle East and Balkan Studies, IFIMES of Ljubljana, the organizers of today's lecture and discussion with Mr. Ilir Meta, with the title The Republic of Albania on the Way to the European Union. A special welcome and gratitude goes to our guest today from Albania, the acclaimed and highly respected Mr. Ilir Meta, Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Albania. I have now Deputy Prime Minister Ilir Meta for many, many years in a region often engulfed in turmoil. In my estimation, Ilir Meta has demonstrated remarkable continuity and long-term capability as a powerful and influential figure in Albania. He has shown the flexibility necessary to adjust successfully to rapidly changing environments. Through all of this, Ilir Meta has remained a pillar of the Albanian nations, an astute observer of affairs in the region. He is able, broadly and true friend of Europe-Atlantic integration. I'm delighted he is able to speak in Ljubljana at this event today organized by IFIMES. There are the words of Mr. Viktor Djakovic, former United States Ambassador and member of IFIMES Council. He sends his greetings to you, to our guest. I am glad today we speak of Albania and her association to European integration and about the challenges of the integration process. I hope that today's event will be a humble contribution to the Albanian way to European Union. The lecture will be given in English. I will be followed by a discussion with Mr. Ilir Meta, moderated by my colleague Mr. Bahtiar Alaf and myself, Ziad Bechirovic. Before I give the floor to Mr. Meta, I would also like to thank Albanian Ambassador to Slovenia, Dr. Sander Kovaci, for very good cooperation. Welcoming in Albanian language. In the ruar ze vendis kraj ministres de minister impunve te jashtme te republikes se shqiperise zoti Ilir Meta. Mirë skendjar në institutin në dëkombëtar për studime të lindjes të se aferme Republikës Shqipëris Mirë skendjart në IFIMES në shtetin e vogël po dhe bukur. Me gzim me mat kemi për cilë fjalimin tuaj fale minderit. And now I give the floor to Mr. Ilir Meta.
Okay. So it's a great pleasure for me to be here today and to be a guest of your institute for different reasons. First of all, because you are very committed to the developments in our region, including Albania. And secondly, because you had the right prediction for the last general elections in Albania, because in several cases, according to your analysis, you were underlining that the party that I do represent was going to be a decisive factor for the coalition government after the elections. And it happened, but the most important are the previous reasons. And I'm in Slovenia not to offer a boring lesson to you, but to have a conversation and hoping to give to you the possibility to address any question or to bring to my attention any idea. First of all, I want to say that Slovenia is a country that we admire for very rapid progress and development, for its very successful integration into NATO and into the European Union, and also my visit here, which follows the visit, the exchange of visits at president level recently. It's another sign of our eagerness to enhance the relations with Slovenia in an excellent level, also in the economic and trade cooperation, as we do have for 2 decades excellent political relations and cooperation between 2 countries and 2 governments. And also to learn from Slovenian experience and to get expertise for our further steps towards membership into the European Union. Slovenia is probably the best case or one of the best cases about the progress and the reforms that helped the country to become a member of the European Union. But I am very much aware that Albania, despite of the present stage in the relations with the European Union and international community in general, is the country that has changed more than everyone in the last 20 years in Southeast Europe and in all previous former communist countries or area. Because Albania has been the most isolated country 20 years ago. Albania was a country which unfortunately was having the most totalitarian communist regime in Europe, which could be compared with only that of Stalin or of that of North Korea. And Albania succeeded in 20 years, despite of many problems and also traumas, to be NATO member and also to be in a new stage in the relations with the European Union after the last November, when the General Affairs Council of Foreign Ministers of the European Union was moving ahead with Albania's application for the candidate status. And now we are working on a questionnaire which was handed to us last December, and by the end of March we are completing all our answers, and we hope that in the near future we are going to get the candidate status, which is another challenge, also not only achievement. For the moment, we are very much focused on visas liberalization process, because this is very important for our citizens, and this is the most tangible achievements that we can offer to our citizens, and also that EU can offer to our citizens. We are happy that the 3 countries of the region, Serbia, Macedonia and Montenegro, gained the visa liberalization recently, and we are very confident that we have met all the requirements asked from this roadmap of the European Commission for visa liberalization. 100%. The first block, which has to do with the security and safety of documents, and also the 4th block, which has to do with the fundamental rights. And also, we are confident that also the 2nd block and the 3rd block are really almost completed, and we have for the moment in Albania EU experts to make the evaluation. And we think that it's very important that also Albania and Bosnia and Herzegovina to gain the visas liberalization as soon as possible within this year, because otherwise our citizens will further suffer from a feeling of discrimination. I am convinced that a year ago we were not able to gain from this process, because when the European Commission did the recommendation, we had produced no biometric passports, because all attention was focused due to the general elections that were held on 28 June last year in producing ID cards that were very essential for the safety of the election process. But now I think that the progress has been spectacular. We have produced more than 500,000 biometric passports of the high standards in Europe from the safety and security point of view. And we have done a huge investments in security control in the border management and also in the fight against organized crime. Also, in the last month we have approved the anti-mafia law, which is very important to destroy mafia also financially and economically, because our experience was that we were going to detain and to isolate mafia people in the prisons, but their economic activities were going on and their criminal activities was continued to be financed. And in this frame, we believe that also European Commission and European Council, and for sure European Parliament, will stay loyal to this principle for visa liberalization, which was named strict and fair. For Albania, visa liberalization is very, very important, and it is not. It is first of all, I think, a question of dignity of the citizens. I don't think that is going to be any problem for EU countries, because almost more than one third of our citizens live today abroad, almost 500,000 Albanian citizens live in other countries, mainly in Greece and in Italy. But everyone knows that how much the citizens are suffering to get a visa, even for making a checkup somewhere, or even as a tourist. We know that the membership of the country into the European Union is not going to be a very easy process, despite of our efforts to accelerate it as much as possible. But anyway, it should be also a natural process. And also we know that European Union, thanks to huge enlargements, is not eager to get new members very easily, let us say. But I think that this is very important because even for other reasons, for example, let's consider Bosnia and Herzegovina, which is a country that represents a major interest for all of us related to the strengthening of the stability of this region and accelerating also the EU integration of Western Balkan countries. Because we have such a situation where the citizens of Bosnia with Croat passports can benefit from the visa liberalization, and the Bosniaks from Bosnia, they cannot benefit from it. I want also to say that we know that also political criteria is very important, and Albania is a country which has a constitution of European standards, very much appreciated also from international institutions, and has the constitution which is based on division of powers and based on check and balance principle. Albania represents still a new democracy, but anyway, I think that it's a democracy which is working. For the moment, we have a kind of problem which has to do with the boycott of the main opposition party, but which is really unjustified and very absurd, because the recent elections were recognized as the best one the country was having and representing a tangible progress in all aspects, despite of the fact that there is still potential for reaching the highest standards also of the other EU countries. And it is very absurd that because the chairman of the Socialist Party was the man who proposed the electoral code, who proposed the administration process of the election and everything, and was having a kind of leading role. And the Prime Minister was following him and offering a consensus. And now we have such a strange situation, which anyway I am sure that we will overcome with maturity, because it's going to be asked from the chairman of the main Socialist Party the reopening of all ballot boxes, after the fact that the counting process was the most transparent country was having. In every counting center there were camera recording every vote. The two main parties were having full parity in the administration, equal representation, 50% to 50%. All representatives of this party, Socialist Party, accepted and signed all the protocols and the results of the elections. We had also the report of OSCE ODIHR. Also the court, Central Election Committee and the court took the decisions for all the claims of all the parties, and the process was over. And this is just an alibi to avoid the political debate from Parliament into the round tables or into the streets, for a very simple fact, because the chairman of our opposition is not member of Parliament, because he didn't put himself in the list of the party for MP, because he wanted to become prime minister without being member of parliament, and it was his right to make such a decision. Government has offered every opportunity to the opposition to play a role in parliament, also to create a parliamentary investigative committee, also to give to them the majority to investigate on everything, but not on court's decision. Because according to our constitution, but I think to the constitution of every EU country or NATO country, or democratic country, the courts are independent from the government and also from the parliament in this case. And also we have a very clear decision of the Constitutional Court in the past related to the parliamentary investigative committees, that such committees cannot investigate on court's decision. I was explaining more than this issue deserves, because otherwise everyone could think that this guy is here to talk only for the success of Albania. But Albania has really many successes, also in the economic area. We are one of the few countries which has a considerable economic growth. And we are one of the few countries which has a significant increase of the foreign direct investments. We are a country which is representing a huge opportunity for foreign investors, considering some factors. First of all, the fact that we have been very isolated in the past, and foreign investors are discovering Albania and the opportunities in the country. Secondly, the situation in the country is completely different in terms of security, in terms of legislation, in terms of guarantees for foreign investors. And also, Albania is representing a huge opportunity not only to Albania and to Albanian market, but to the whole region. Thanks to the very good relations that Albania has with all neighboring countries, with Greece and Italy for sure. And now that I'm talking with you, Prime Minister of Albania and Prime Minister of Italy, are having a press conference after signing a strategic partnership between the two countries, but also with Macedonia, with Montenegro, with Kosovo, and with all other countries in the region, with Bulgaria, also with Serbia. Our relations are going to be improved in a very steady way. And what is very important for the investors, our infrastructure with all neighboring countries is going to be improved significantly. By the end of the spring, it's going to be finished one of the most modern highways, not only in the region, but even in Europe, which connects Albania with Kosovo, which has been a huge investment implemented from a very known group, Bethel Enka, and which is shortening so much the distance between Albania and Kosovo, and which is going to be a very important corridor for development, for trade, exchanges, and which we believe is not going to end, neither in border with Kosovo, nor in the border with between Kosovo and Serbia, but which is going to niche in southern Serbia, and which is going to be a very important corridor of development for this part of the region. Also, our infrastructure with Montenegro has been improved significantly, and most of the road from Tirana to the border with Montenegro is a very good highway, and investments are going on. Also, in the relations with Macedonia, we are building in 2 years a new road, very modern road, which is shortening a lot the distance between Tirana and Skopje. And also we are improving very much the infrastructure with Greece. We are now in a new stage of the investments in energy area. We are a country that we have suffered a lot from shortages, and now we have left past this situation, and we are in a new stage, attracting a billion of euro investments in energy from a very known companies, Statkraft, one of the biggest in the world, Norwegian company, Austrian companies, even Verbund, many Italian companies, because Albania has a huge potential, so in particular in renewable energy, in particular in hydro production, thanks to the fact that 2/3 of the country are mountains, which means also rivers. And also during this visit here, we agreed to cooperate on management of waters, because this is a great resource for us for the future. But unfortunately, until now, we have not managed it properly, and Slovenia is doing better. I want to let you know that the main pillar of our integration policy, of our regional policy, is a good neighborhood relations. We are very much aware that the success of neighbors is our success. We are very much aware that if other countries in the region are going to be stable and are going to get closer to the EU, we are also getting faster to EU. And as you know, Albania is doing the best to encourage the Albanians throughout the region, wherever do they live, to be constructive, to work for the EU integration of the countries where do they live, because this is the only way that they will enjoy all the rights that they deserve. And we ask always to show maturity, because you know that in our region, thanks to a difficult heritage that we have from the past, for nothing we can destroy everything. And I think that it's not the time to continue or to repeat such a habit, because now it's the time to build. To build friendship and to build a common future, because this is the only way for all of us to overcome also these ethnic problems which have been really a very, very big problem for all the countries and all the nations. Because every nation in the Balkans is somewhere majority in one state or in one country, and is somewhere else is in minority. The only way to overcome the problems is all the nations to use the same standards related to the minorities everywhere, and not to use double standards. I'm glad once again to be here, and I'd like to give opportunity to all the distinguished participants to address any question or to express their opinion or idea for everything they want. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mehta, and would like to ask Mr. Bakhtiradov to start the discussion.
I have some questions now. The first is, during the election campaign last year in Albania, if you must get out two surveys and forecast for the election results. We predicted that you and your party, LSI, would be the key player in forming the new government. This actually happened. How do you look upon those events today, and have you ever thought that a left-right coalition is possible in Albania?
Okay. This is the first.
Yes. Can I...
There are some questions here?
Yeah. Yes, we will have.
Okay, 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 yes. Okay, okay, okay.
Because okay. Not connected for this.
Okay,
question.
Okay, okay. So, yes, you were very clear in predicting that the socialist movement for integration that I do represent was going to be a key factor for the majority, so that neither Democratic Party nor Socialist Party could form a government alone. These two parties knew better than you before. That's the reason that with full consensus they did a law against the party that I do represent. And the only one that could complain for the elections, it was me and my party. Because they did in consensus with the proposal of the Socialist Party leader, who should be my ally, an electoral law which was excluding us from the administration process, despite of the fact that we had been the third legitimate party in the country. And also, by doing such regional distribution seats, because it was regional proportion, which was damaging our representation. But anyway, as you predicted, our party was a decisive factor and a very legitimate one, because everyone knows that one MP of our party represents more than 20,000 voters, and one MP of other parties represents 7,000 or something like that. And I was not predicting before the elections that we're going to have a coalition with the Democratic Party, Right Center Party, but it was impossible that Socialist Party and my party to form a coalition. It was a difficult choice for us, because we had two choices, in fact. One was to make a coalition government with Democratic Party and to guarantee a stable government and functioning of the institutions. And another one was not to do it, which had many risks. And we could take a responsibility for bringing a mess in the country, because we couldn't form a government with a Socialist Party. So we did something courageous. We were not very sure how it was going to function, because, as I said, it was a difficult choice, but I can say to you that it's going to function very well, and we have a frame coalition agreement with the Democratic Party, where are included many priorities of our party, and I think that it's going to function very seriously. You see, you know that also here in Slovenia you have a government with five parties in coalition, and in Albania now for sure that always we will have coalitions due to the new electoral system, which is regional proportional and which makes almost impossible that one party to form alone the majority. What was done in Albania is not something new in your countries, is not something new in Austria and many other countries, but of course it was something new in Albania. It's the first experience like that, and I think that it's going to be a successful one. So I think that for when you harmonize your goals with those of the others, and when you have some common goals, as it is EU integration, as it is the visas liberalization, and many others like that, for sure it can work.
Thank you. The second question is, to what extent will Edi Rama and the Socialist Party have a negative effect on Albania due to the boycott of the parliament? What is the background of the boycott, the elections of, or perhaps something completely different?
Okay. I tried to explain earlier more because I thought that someone was going to address such a question, which is normal. I think that Mr. Ram, unfortunately, has only one intention: to damage the country interests, to damage the image of Albania, to provoke unnecessary tension, because you know what is happening. Tomorrow, President has invited Prime Minister and Mr. Rama to discuss how to overcome this situation. 2 weeks ago, the Parliamentary Assembly of Council of Europe was passing a resolution. And the resolution was a kind of package for helping both sides to cooperate in order to overcome this situation. It was asking the Socialist Party to quit boycott and to enter in Parliament. It was asking to majority to create a parliamentary investigative committee on the elections based on claims of opposition, but by respecting the constitution, and things like that. And of course, we supported it, and we expressed our readiness to implement it as it is. But Mr. Rama was saying, no, I have only one condition: to reopen the ballot boxes. And he has been recently in Brussels to see some socialist friends and is informing them and trying to get any statement from them to use it as a pressure in Albania, which is very unserious, and some of them now have sent statements that no, we were told wrong, and this is not our position, because we cannot ask something which comes against the independence of the courts, etc., etc. So I think that this is only a personal issue of Mr. Rama for narrow interests, not for Albanian interests. And there are many senior politicians in the Socialist Party. They are elected also in the recent elections member of parliament, and they have made clear that the boycott is an alibi of Mr. Rama for justifying the losing of the elections and not resigning as party leader. And they made clear that at the beginning of next month they would enter in parliament, despite of what is the decision of Mr. Rama. They accused him for not gathering the party for us to discuss this issue. They have asked a secret vote in the parliamentary group to enter or not in parliament, and he's not allowing that the deputies to decide if they want to enter or not, because personally he is not member of parliament, and he fears that if the party enters in parliament, other people that are his opponents will play more prominent role, and he will be over shadowed. Despite of that, we will do our best to be very constructive and to do everything the government can. He has opportunities if he wants to open ballot boxes, certain ballot boxes now, which are only due to the judicial course. He can complain to the prosecutor office, offering any evidence for manipulation or fraud, and the prosecutor office can make decision to verify certain boxes, etc. But it is not the government, it is not the parliament, because this is a court business. Now, this is the problem. And it's not only the problem that this is going to be, if, which cannot happen, taken in consideration such a request. It's not only the problem that it's going to be a very heavy precedent in long term for the stability of the country and of institutions, but this is going to be a heavy precedent for all the countries where that are member of OSCE and where OSCE and ODIHR are observing the elections. Because if such requests can be taken in consideration in Albania, you see, tomorrow or after tomorrow, I don't want to mention countries in the region or in Caucasus or somewhere, every opposition party, 1 year after the elections, when everything is over, when the report of OSCE ODIHR is over, when the courts have taken the decision, can ask the reopening of ballot boxes for transparency. And if someone is saying, why you are asking it and why you are doing this, they will say, we have a precedent. This precedent is in Albania. And there is no one from the representatives, what is strange, because you asked for the background of this boycott. There is no one commissioner, representative of Socialist Party. They had around 30,000 throughout the country. No one that has not signed these protocols of the results. There is no one. There is no evidence that the Socialist Party was sending, was bringing in Central Election Committee or in the court, or was sending to the prosecutor office for manipulation or fraud and things like that. So this is just it is a personal agenda. It is not a country agenda, which dominates in such emotional and irresponsible, because we cannot say irresponsible behavior. From the very beginning, we have been open for a dialogue, discussing everything. Of course, the elections were not perfect, and there are also the recommendations of the OSCE ODIHR for the future elections. And it was made clear from the government that we invite the opposition to take lead for reforming the electoral code, and we will vote every suggestion that the opposition is bringing to the parliament for improving election code or everything else.
Thank you. The third is also in connection with elections. As you know, the local elections will be held next year. Are you going to form a coalition with Mr. Salih Berisha and the Democratic Party for the purpose of the local elections?
Okay. So, something is very clear, that this coalition with Democratic Party will complete its term without a discussion. Because this is in the interest of the country, and this is also in our interest to make clear that we are serious and we do not do just temporary games for different reasons. About the local elections, I think it's too early. It's too early. But anyway, we will do everything that helps the stability of this coalition government. Because local elections are local elections, are administrative elections, and people are focused more on the quality of the mayors than really on the party representation. For example, the southern part of Albania, which was known more as a leftist, was lost completely in the last general elections, and we were in coalition, all the left, 2007, because of wrong people. Because it was the idea that despite that there are good or bad guys, these people belong to the left and they will vote. And it was lost completely. It was unexpected, because in the local elections, the people are going to be concentrated more on the qualities of the persons and on their credibility, what they can do for the community.
Thank you for these answers, but now we will go to Europe, not in the elections. As a NATO member, Albania plays an important role in the stability of the Balkans. How do you see the region in the next 5 years, bearing in mind the Greek Macedonian dispute, Kosovo, Bosnia?
I'd like to see it within the framework of Greek Agenda 2014. Probably you are not familiar with that. It's a plan or it's a commitment launched from Mr. Papandreou after winning the elections, that considering that on 2014 we are going to have one century from the First World War, which started from the Western Balkans, which was not named like that 100 years ago, to complete the membership of those countries into the European Union, which is not possible if we talk from today, from present situation. But I hope that Macedonia is doing more efforts and is cooperating closely with Greece and with the representative of the United Nations to solve this problem. And I think that this Greek government is a very moderate one. And it will be more difficult for them to solve such issue with another Greek government in the future. And I think that Macedonia should behave in more realistic way, not being concentrated very much on history and evoking too much Big Alexander, because I think that the main focus should be European Union and the prosperity of all Macedonian citizens despite of their ethnic belongings. Because otherwise, if there is not a quick progress, if Macedonia is not taking its seat that it deserves in NATO, and if not, if it is not going ahead in the relations with the EU, then no one can exclude tensions, economic problems, which I think is not in the benefit of Macedonia, first of all, but it is not in benefit of all of us. And I hope also that also Greek government will do its efforts to reach a compromise. We are very interested in the stability of Macedonia. And we are very supportive to moderate the inter-ethnic relations there. There were some not nice developments because, as I said to you, a lot of energies are going to be wasted for the past, for the history. History divides us in Balkans because everyone has its own history. The only thing that can bring us in common is the EU. EU future and EU project of our countries. This is the only way. We had some months ago this debate about the encyclopedia. Unnecessary debate. Just to poison inter-ethnic relations. Why to spend energies for such things? So, I hope very much that this problem is going to be solved, because if Macedonia is not progressing, if Serbia is not progressing, if Bosnia is not progressing, also it is a problem for us. And about Bosnia, Herzegovina,
and Kosovo.
Kosovo at the end. About Bosnia, Herzegovina, we are very interested in the consolidation of this country, which is a very specific one. I was surprised very much in the NATO foreign ministers meeting when I was hearing some colleagues from the north of Europe that were trying to compare Bosnia with some countries far from this region, because we know that Bosnia has been, it is, and it will continue to be a specific case. And knowing this reality and trying to moderate it, it should be a factor of stability and factor of integration, factor of peace in our region. So we hope that all communities there will do more efforts to live together, to consolidate this country as much as they can. But also I think that the European Union, United States and other interested countries in the stability of Bosnia and in the prosperity of each community there, to cooperate in a constructive way. We are going to open our embassy in Bosnia very soon, because we didn't have until now, and I don't understand why, because we are very interested in the stability of this country, and it affects the stability of the whole region. About Kosovo, we do not support Kosovo as a new state, only because the majority there are Albanians. We support it because this is a reality. This is a reality inherited, and it was the only choice, inherited from Milosevic regime. What Milosevic regime left in Kosovo was the independence from Serbia. Because after such genocide, there was no opportunity for cohabitation of Kosovo with Serbia. But it is very important to guarantee the cohabitation of Albanians and Serb minority and other ethnic groups there. And this is a very important commitment also of Albania. And we have made it very clear. Also, we have been committed to support this decentralization plan, which helps, according to Ahtisaari plan, the Serb community in Kosovo to feel more relaxed, more comfortable, and to take more responsibility. We have been committed to support them, even financially. Albanian government is financing about 400,000 euro in the new Serb commune in Kosovo, Gračanica, because we want to give a very concrete signal of supporting the Serb community in Kosovo to live there, but also trying to give a signal to everyone that these people need also not only safety, which I think today is of the high standards in Kosovo, but also economic and social conditions, because if they are not going to have better economic opportunities, if they are not going to be employed somewhere, of course that for economic reasons they will be forced to leave Kosovo, not because of the discrimination, as many Albanians left Albania to other countries, as many Kosovo people in Kosovo left Kosovo to other countries for economic reasons, etc. So about Kosovo, we think that also step by step, also Serbia should recognize this new reality, because it is in the benefit of Serbs. First of all, it is in benefit of Serbs in Kosovo, because from an unfortunate tense situation in northern Mitrovica, because in the rest of Kosovo situation I think is very normal, which was shown also from the participation, growing participation of Serbs in the recent general local elections. I think that people are suffering from the lack of stability, which is provoked from these parallel structures that, first of all, are not just damaging function of Kosovo as a whole, but that are really threatening the safety, the security, and the prosperity of the people there, of the citizens there. We hope that in 5 years the relations of Albania with Serbia will be like the relations that we do have today with Montenegro and with other neighboring countries. 10 years ago, I can tell to you that we almost didn't have any relation with Montenegro. But in a few years, we have undertaken concrete measures. We abolished visas. We opened new cross-border points. And now the relations between Albania and Montenegro are really excellent. Also with Serbia, we want the same. We have different positions on Kosovo. But Kosovo is not a bilateral issue between Albania and Serbia, but Albania and Serbia have a very important role to play for the stability of the region and for the integration of our countries and of the whole region into the European Union. Also, we are interested about the Albanians, ethnic Albanians that live in southern Serbia, in Preševo Valley, and we encourage them to be integrated there because we want to see them as European citizens in a European country that we hope Serbia will be one day, and this day is coming as soon as possible.
My last question is economical now. According to the figures of the World Financial Institutions, Albania is the only state in Europe which has marked a positive growth last year. How did you manage to do this?
Okay, so for sure that Albania marks a very positive case about keeping economic growth, considerable economic growth, in a very difficult time for the others. And of course, it has not been very easy, but there were some factors, I think. First of all, as you probably remember, Albania 96-97 suffered a lot because of the collapse of these pyramid schemes. And since that moment, we were very careful about macroeconomic stability. Secondly, Albania in the past also was representing a country of opportunities but also of a certain risk, which forced the banks in Albania, and we have many banks in Albania, to be strict about lending credits because of the risk. In Slovenia, there was no risk, and banks were lending a lot, also in other countries. In Albania, there was more risk. So, in this, also, our policy, monetary policy, was very careful and supervised very seriously from our national bank. Something else, I think, has to do with the fact that we have a huge emigration. 1.5 million Albanians, they live abroad. Of course, their remittances were decreased, but not very much, 10 to 15%. And also, Albania is a country which has huge potentials for development. It's not like other countries that are developed and that have more difficulties to go ahead. Considering this vacuum, the country was offering a lot of possibilities for investments during this time, and that's the reason that also foreign direct investments were increased very significantly and will continue to be increased, because only in tourism and in the production of the energy, we expect billions of euros to be invested in these 4 years and in the future.
Thank you, Excellency, for your answers, and we can, according to your answers, to make another research regarding Albania, like that we make during the elections, and we have a very good. Now, from the public, if anyone have any question for His Excellency, Mr. Melchior Kokasin.
Mr. Minister, first of all, congratulations for your presentation. But as you said, we are very much interested on the progress inside of your parliament. So this is something what we are looking for, positive news from Albania. Is there a need for some international mediators who might help to overbridge maybe the disputes between Mr. Rama and his party or the other political factors inside of Albania, because as long as this blockade is going on, collateral damage is bigger and bigger. Albania was much advanced compared with Bosnia a few months ago. Now situation is changing, and I believe that the time is expiring. So the second question, which I would like to connect with the first one, is do you see any benefits in the case that, for instance, United States of America would appoint special representative for Western Balkan countries? Would such a presence be useful, fruitful for speeding up the progress in democratic development in the country, especially due to the fact that you're already in NATO and some countries failed, your direct neighbors failed, Bosnia failed in the action plan? And the very last question, Sobrani in Macedonia a week ago adopted a resolution of the European Parliament on Srebrenica with enormous majorities, 70 in favor and just one against. So three parliaments already adopted this resolution, and the debate is going on about that in Belgrade as well. Your parliament didn't put it on its agenda yet. Can we expect any kind of attitude towards this challenge in the near future? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. About boycott, we should be very fair with each other. The easiest thing is to say that the two sides should find a compromise. But I don't think that there was a lack of effort from the government to offer compromise. The compromise that Mr. Rama wants, it's very expensive. Not for the government, for the country. It's very expensive because it undermines the whole constitutional system of our country. And he knows it very well. Also, it put in question not only the credibility of our constitutional system for the future, it represents not only a heavy precedent also in other countries, where OSCE and ODIHR participate as observer in the elections, but also it is very dangerous, because the politics cannot be based on precedents, because in this way it is unpredictable. So we are ready to do everything. But it's not up to the government, it is not up to the parliament to challenge the court's decisions. We cannot do it. You cannot do it in your country. Martin Schulz cannot do it in his country. Somebody else cannot do it in his country. And here we have one side that has accepted and respected the elections, that has accepted the report of OSCE ODIHR and is willing further to improve the standards of the elections, that is offering to Mr. Rama everything he has asked, but something that we cannot offer because it is very expensive. How we can talk for a rule of law tomorrow if we do it? How we can talk for rule of law? As we respect the decisions of Constitutional Court when they reject government laws, government agreements, we are forced also to respect the decisions of the court for the elections. There is one way, there is something that international community can do to make clear to Mr. Rama that international community cannot be invested to destroy the rule of law in Albania, first, cannot be invested to challenge the independence of the courts in Albania, and also international community cannot be invested to destroy the credibility of international community. Because for the elections, we had an international referee, which was OSCE ODIHR. If this guy wants to work against, you know very well that there are senior politicians in the Socialist Party that have made clear that this party should go in parliament, that boycott is unreasonable and is trying to destroy the EU perspective of the country. And they are very known figures, and they are in Socialist Party for a very long time. Mr. Islami, former foreign minister, former minister of finance, former speaker of parliament, someone who is very known. Mr. Malay, former minister of economy, minister of finance, head of parliamentary group of Socialist Party. Mr. Blushi, the same, and other people, you know very well. And you know very well that this guy is exerting pressure on them in a very totalitarian way, saying to them that if you do it, I will expel you from the party. So, first of all, we cannot be compared with other countries. We are Albania. We have our own problems, and we don't intend to hide our problems. We are willing to work with each other in Albania. We are willing to work with you very openly, very fairly. There was a resolution from the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe. We may disagree with some parts of the resolution, which were exaggerated, but we made clear we are ready to implement the resolution as a package as it is. But if someone wants to keep as a hostage not only his party, but also the European perspective of the country, it cannot happen. Of course, it can delay the chances of the country for a certain moment. But Albania will continue to go in the right direction with maturity, being always open to international community, and first of all, respecting our constitution. We should not continue with such precedents that undermine the constitutional system of the country. You were raising critics often, I mean European Parliament, European Commission, in the progress report and everyone, about the functioning of independent functioning of the courts, of the constitutional institutions, etc. We cannot go against such recommendations, because otherwise we are destroying the principles of the European Albania. Excuse me for this very long speech.
Thank you very much, because we haven't time. From the protocol is calling us. Now, Mr. Ziad.
I hope you enjoyed this lecture and discussion as much as I did. I would like to thank Mr. Ilir Lameta, Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Albania, for his contribution to better understanding of Albania and its way to European Union. At the end, I would like to invite you all to our next lecture, which will take place probably in the first days of March. Our guest will be a very important politician from Western Balkan country. Welcome. At the end, this is a gift for our publication of our institute.
Okay, thank you very much.